And welcome to Warwick Castle's Flight of the Eagle show. My name is Chris, and along with David and James and a few friendly friends, I'm hopefully going to entertain you for the next 20 minutes or so. First bird that we're going to have a look at is going to be coming in from this direction over here. We're going to have a look at one of the largest eagles in the world. And in a couple of moments' time, hopefully we'll get Nikita in here for you to have a look at. Nikita is an absolutely huge bird. Well, if it looks as though it's going to fly into you, it probably is. So keep your head and your eyes on the bird. This is Nikita, and she is absolutely huge. As I said, one of the largest eagles in the world. And Nikita is about 8 years of age. And at 8 years of age, she's obviously worked here at the castle for quite a while. She was born in a zoo in the Czech Republic, but came to England about 6 or 7 years ago. And if you came to the first show at 12:30, then you will have met Marvin, our baby Stella Sea Eagle. And this is eventually what he's going to look like when he gets a little bit older. And she really is a stunning bird. So the black and white plumage blends in very well with tundra regions of the world. And Nikita is an awful long way away from home. Out in the wild, she would live in Eastern Russia, Japan, and Korea. There's a peninsula called Kamchatka, the Sea of Hokkaido, and that's where you would expect to find the sea eagle at home in the wild. And of course, Nikita isn't interested in going back to the wild, and that's quite, because as far as she's concerned, she gets all of her breakfast here at the castle. Her job initially is to go up onto Bird Tower, and that's the first little tower that we come to, but she's actually gone a little further and has actually worked her way onto Clarence Tower. And that is of course a very, very, very beautiful sight to see the eagle in the sky. But Nikita is very keen to press on to the next bit of her job. And the next bit of her job is to actually go all the way to the top of Guy's Tower. Now, sadly, that means that somebody has to run all the way to the top of the tower. Yes. David, although he got a good job presenting the first show, has the bad job in that he has to run all the way to the top of the tower. And I think David is actually going to try and call her across onto that part of the castle. But David, just run all the way to the top. It's a slick operation, this. He'll be cursing me at this point. And you're probably thinking to yourself that David is going to be hours getting up those steps. I'm sure that each and every one of you, when you went up those steps, felt a certain amount of pain. Gravity really does hurt, but when David is match fit, he can get up there in 27 seconds. And I expect him to come out very shortly on the right-hand side, and I want you to give him a really big round of applause when he comes out. He'll give us a wave, and there he is already. It's only his first day back at work, so that will have really hurt him. Now, as soon as Nikita sees David, then she's going to be trying to make her way up onto the top of Guy's Tower. And that, of course, means that she has to take off and go out in that direction. It might seem a bit strange, but because his eagle is so large, the only way that it's going to be able to get up there is by using the energy of the air that we have today. And essentially, the wind blowing up in this direction hits the back of the castle and, well, essentially lifts Nikita up into the air. Then across onto Spy Tower, and of course, Spy Tower is a fairly serious height up there. You can see for miles all around, but she'll be looking round over her shoulder, looking for David. And of course, at some point soon will be good, you should be jumping off and taking off and going all the way around there. She's not incidentally interested, and she doesn't get a reward for actually just sitting on the top of Spy Tower. So essentially, the only way that she gets a big reward is if she flies to the top of the castle. And to get her to go all the way up to the top of the castle, we have to use a fairly scrumptious big piece of food. And we usually use a small arm of a child left over from the school group, something like that. About a 3 or 4 year old is the right portion. Now, Nikita is up at the top of the castle, and this is where it gets interesting, because of course, now on the top of the hill, it's all downhill, and I'm going to call her in here to give her the rest of her tea. And of course, in the wild, this eagle is capable of catching things. It would normally scoop a fish off the surface of the water with its enormous big yellow feet, but I'm going to get it to stop hopefully on this log here. And that requires a bit of a control to get to this point here. And of course, Nikita, well, is a big thing. It's a bit like an oil tanker, and as soon as she sees that I put that bit of food on there, she's going to be on her way in, but she does have to throw an awful lot of work out to slow herself down. And you will lap at the air bridge as she wibbles and wobbles herself to a standstill. Okay, give her a really big round of applause. She's done very, very well. And this really, truly is huge, isn't it? Most people are very impressed by this serious tin opener that she has on the front of her face. And of course, that is designed for eating frozen meals. I know that you're going to be looking at that piece of food that just disappeared down her throat. And that was actually pretty near half of a squirrel. So let's give her a really big round of applause. She did very, very well for us. And whoops, and easy. Yeah, you've got to come back round into the wind. It's quite tricky to get Nikita to go in because you've got to go in with the wind up her backside, which of course is really quite strong here today. In you go, mate. Thank you. So, we're now going to move on to the next bird, and the next bird is going to be making his way up from this direction over here. We're going to have a look at Frank, and Frank is an Egyptian vulture. He really is quite a bit of a kamikaze pilot, I have to tell you, and this is going to get an awful lot closer to you than Nikita. This really is a bird that sort of twists and turns. Hopefully, we should get away with this relatively safely, and she's going to hopefully come around the corner in a couple of moments' time. Frank actually also came from a zoo in Germany, and has been working here at the castle for probably about 18 months now, so at some point soon, we should have Frank, and Frank will be working his way up here. And of course, he is one of my favourite birds. He's actually quite small, whereas vultures can get really very large indeed. They go up to the size of an Andean condor with a 10'6" wingspan. As we're hoping to try and get that in there for you in the show a little bit later on. But this is one of the smaller vultures. And as I said, he's a bit of a kamikaze pilot, so you might need to sort of keep your eyes fairly focused. Don't worry, he's only ever killed one small child. Okay. Now, I would love to say that Frank is actually a beautiful bird, but if you do get a chance to see Frank up close and personal, you'll see he's not really that cute at all. In fact, often when I get him out, people feel compelled to tell me he's the ugliest bird they've ever seen. He's got spiky feathers sitting off the back of his head. Most of his head is bald. And really, to be honest, he is quite ugly, but he does have a very useful role in life, and his job is to find dead things. Now, if you're a big vulture, then it's great being a big vulture, because of course you can find a large dead animal, and because you're big, you can sit there with 200 or 300 of the vultures, and you can find your way to the front. Frank, because he's a small vulture, is always at the back of the queue. And this essentially means that Frank is a bit bad-tempered. He often gets it sort of horribly wrong. And, I think he's just trying to kill someone. He would be really very happy, incidentally, if one of you was to have a heart attack and die now. He'd be going like, yahoo! But in the wild, he doesn't tend to compete with the bigger vultures for food. What he tends to do is do his own kind of thing. And in the wild, Frank would spend a lot of his time just hunting for small morsels of food. Maybe things that have been hit on the road, ideal opportunity. Even a sun-baked earthworm would be an absolute gem for this bird. He loves baby birds as well, and he's one of the vultures in the world that will actually kill things. He will quite happily work his way into a nesting colony of birds, and there he will steal baby birds that are unattended. But one of the other great goodies that are in a nest is of course eggs. And for me and you getting in an egg, it's really just a simple case of hitting it with our spoons. But Frank doesn't have that kind of cutlery available to him. And what he does, actually uses his brain. What he will do is actually pick up very sharp stones and repeatedly throw them at the egg until they have broken. And of course, that means that Frank can get into the goodies on the inside. Now, you know, we're pushing it a bit here. Frank, you're doing a great job, mate, but you're scaring everybody to death. And of course, that was very close. And of course, each time Frank completes one of these exercises, then he gets a reward. So he probably isn't really enjoying this at the moment. Although we would like to think that if we had a pair of wings, we'd be flying around the castle and enjoying the views and the sights. But this is Frank at work. He knows that this is how he gets his food. And of course, the only time he gets a reward is if he does something, correctly. If I put my hands up into the air like this, this essentially means do something a bit more exciting. And what it's a bit like, I suppose, is that your swimming instructor saying to you, essentially tread water. So Frank doesn't really like this, and all he's praying for all of the time is for me to put my hands down so that he can come in and get the reward. He's brilliant, isn't he? Now, you might have noticed that Frank actually has a bell on, and that bell is there so that you can locate him reasonably closely, and of course that has a range of perhaps about a quarter of a mile or so in normal circumstances, and that's how you would find a lost bird of prey. But for here and now, playing over the tops of your heads, it just gives you a millisecond to duck out and away, really. Now, you're going to make sure, Frank, that you stay over the top of the archery, okay? Going like, yeah, I've got it done, yeah. And of course, he's doing a brilliant job here today. Absolutely great. And I'm going to be really very kind to Frank and give him the rest of his team. So let's give Frank a really big round of applause. He's done very, very well for us. Now, that round of applause does actually mean something to Frank. And what it means is essentially your job is over, Frank. So disappear, go back to base. And if you haven't discovered the birds here at the castle, then they're essentially down this river road, round to the right-hand side, and you'll find a wonderful collection of birds. And Frank is actually supposed to land on that man's arm down there, Jay. Frank is actually a real character, and that's why I like him. He's actually brilliant. But what he does, he often picks his part up, and he'll go down there, he'll fly, and sometimes he comes all the way back up here for another encore, because he loves having a round of applause, you see. That's what he's all about. So, Frank, we don't like you, mate, okay? You've done your bit. Would anybody like to buy a very low mileage motor? Frank, you're sacked, mate, okay? We do love you, Frank, but it is a bit silly, you know. We can only do so many encores. Last year, once, he did this four times, right? It was like, really, Frank, this show is not about you. Okay. Frank, land! Yay! Brilliant. Now, I know that you're going to like this next bird, and this is one of my favourite birds also here at the castle. I'm going to introduce you a baby owl. This is Ernie, and Ernie is about 6 months of age. And at 6 months of age, he sort of thinks the world is absolutely wonderful. Over the last 6 months or so, Ernie has grown from an egg that was 75 millimeters across, or 3 inches if you're an old bunny. And on a rich diet of rats and mice, he's got to this kind of size. And he's not the biggest owl in the world, but he's the biggest owl in Africa. Having said that, his mum and his dad did actually originate in Kenya. Ernie was born in a very exciting place called Wolverhampton. And of course, Wolverhampton's not a bad place, but certainly not the kind of place where you would expect to have an owl like Ernie flying around. And Ernie came to work here at the castle, and it's my pleasure to show you him and to get him to do something a little bit more exciting. Now, Ernie has just started to get to grips with life here at the castle, and one of the ways that we get the birds tame in the first place is by essentially getting them to see people up close and personal. But a direct stare in animal language is usually taken as an aggressive stance. The fact that you're all staring at Ernie initially was a bit scary for him. So by putting posts around the edge of the arena and giving him a reward, here, there and everywhere, he's now starting to understand that you're not all about to run up to the rope, rugby tackle him to the floor and eat him, because of course now he thinks he's brave. But the first time he met me, he wouldn't fly onto my hand. All of the birds are exactly the same, and getting them to soar and fly around the sky is hundreds of hours of work. But this is how every bird starts the career. Whether you're an owl, an eagle, a vulture, it matters not. They all have to understand they're getting some food. And to be honest, this is much the same as, I guess, a wild owl would be taught to hunt by his mum and his dad. And Ernie is at that very difficult stage in life where he's starting to become independent. His mum and his dad worshipped every little twig that he sat on, but at about 6 months of age, they are getting a bit fed up of Ernie in the nest with the mobile phone ringing all the time, slamming doors, and they want him to leave home. And I can remember the first time my mum and dad asked me to leave home. It was horrendous. I was 18 years of age. I managed to cling on till I was 27. It was brilliant. But Ernie is not going to be in that position. He just has to get on with life, and he has to understand that life is fairly difficult. But I would love to get Ernie to soar and fly around in the sky. And why doesn't he do that kind of thing? Well, the reason he doesn't do that is because Ernie's day job is essentially to be a tree, and or maybe be a rock or something like that. And he spends most of his day hiding, camouflaged, so that he can't be killed by other predators. Imagine Africa, everything would want to eat Ernie, and that's because he's very slow at flying. If I ask him to fly and soar around the sky, all he does is actually fly to the nearest tree. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to show you Ernie hunting. And this is a new thing that we're trying to get Ernie to do. We're going to try and get him to catch something. So I'm going to set the scene for you. Ernie, I want you to go up into the tree. Are you looking at me? Listen, listen. The bottom right-hand limb, and I just want you to sit there for a couple of moments while I explain what's going on. Now, you're probably thinking to yourself, Ernie's paying attention and he's listening to me. But it doesn't matter where I let him go, at the castle, he always flies onto that branch, all the time. So I can get away with that. But if Ernie was a wild owl, he'd pull himself tight up against that tree and he'd disappear. Now, because we've got Ernie happy to work in daylight hours, we can show you Ernie hunting and catching something. And it's this part that's getting quite exciting for Ernie. He's learning to use his feet, and that's the only way he can catch his breakfast, is by pouncing on it. So imagine the scene, he's there at night time, he's probably ladder his way to the top of the tree, got a massive field of vision, his big eyes help him see in the dark, his ears are very, very acute and can help him locate things moving around in the dark, and when he sees something, he just flies straight towards it and then pounces on it. And that's what we're going to do now. I'm going to throw out a piece of food onto the floor. What I want you to watch in this exercise is the fancy footwork. So at the last moment, both feet will come forward, punching it to the floor, thus securing himself a meal. Okay, Ernie? We're going for action, drama, and excitement. Okay, ready? Go, 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 go! Hey, what was that? I've got to tell you that if you land beside a rat in the wild, it's not going to be there when you bend down and pick it up, right? And I know that you can do this. I'm not going to give you anything for nothing. I want a bit more focus, a bit more aggression, a bit more sort of just anything really than landing beside it. Go back up into the tree and we'll have another go at that. Go. Now, you're probably thinking to yourself, this owl is absolutely rubbish. And there is room for improvement, it has to be said. But when I tell you this story about Ernie whilst he was practicing for this show, you're going to be sort of like quite amazed, because I was absolutely shocked. Ernie was sitting in that tree, minding his own business, the world was wonderful, and instead of the calm, relaxed owl that you see in front of you, Ernie starts going like this, bobbing his head up and down, moving from side to side. He took off from there, flew to the top of the tall, thin tree in the courtyard, and he actually grabbed a squirrel. This is in broad daylight with a 5 foot wingspan, traveling at 25 miles an hour. The squirrel had to be blind or daft to be caught by Ernie. He fell out of the tree into the courtyard, and if you saw an owl scrapping with a squirrel, you'd want to have a look. And so every person that was in the courtyard ran across to me. I'm pretty sure that, well, he probably thought they were going to nick his squirrel. So he squeezed the squirrel to death with his enormous, big, powerful feet, and he actually swallowed the whole squirrel down in one go. The only reason I knew it was a squirrel is because he had a big furry tail sticking out to the side of his mouth for about 4 hours. So I know that you can use those feet, Ernie. I'm going to give you one more chance, okay? You ready? Go, 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 go! Here he comes, perfect line. You've got to be the fattest owl in the world, Ernie. You're not really taking this job very seriously at all, are you? So let's give you a very small round of applause, Ernie. Everybody loves it, don't they? And of course, Ernie will be very happy with that because he's got his lunch. And of course, we need to switch Ernie off, so I'm going to pop him in this box here. This isn't a punishment, incidentally. This is just to keep Ernie nice and safe whilst we move on to one of the largest birds of prey in the whole world, an Andean condor. Now, we look up at Guy's Tower. You can see there's a flag there. Whilst we've been chatting and flying young Ernie, we've actually transported Rosie, our baby Andean condor, all the way to the top of the castle. Fingers crossed, we're going to be able to see if we can get Rosie to jump off the top of the castle. So, with a signal handed down from generation to generation, throw the bird off. This is Rosie, and it has to be said that Rosie, for the last couple of months, has actually been flying around up in North Georgia learning to fly. Here at the castle, it's going to be a little bit more complicated for this bird to actually get into this arena, but she has fantastic eyesight. In the wild, it would circle around at great heights looking for its breakfast, and of course, it's a bit, that was halfway there. That was halfway there, Rosie. You're sort of getting the idea, but this is where we want lunch over here. So Rosie has actually got all of the flying skills that she requires, but is not paying any attention whatsoever, and has gone the complete opposite direction. And I can't say that that was a very successful end to the show, but it is the end of the show. So let's give Rosie and all of the birds a really big round of applause. They've done very, very well for us. We are going to be practicing with Rosie straight after the show and maybe putting her through her paces, but it doesn't look as though she's going to be able to get from there to here in the time scale that we've got. So enjoy the rest of your day here at the castle. Thanks very much for coming along to watch the show, and bye-bye for now.